followers of the island nation will be hoping that today brings their first ever Olympic medal. The modern games having started back in 1896. So the 120-year wait may well be down to its last 7 hours. Well, this is how things look throughout the course of this morning session. We start with a game which will settle the 11th place between Brazil, the hosts, and Kenya, who have in all honesty been pretty disappointing. We then move on to the playoff for 9th and 10th. It's then the four effectively semi-finals for 5th, 6th, 7th and 8th. Argentina against Australia, the second of those matches. And then on to the medal semi-finals. Fiji against Japan. And Japan have written all sorts of headlines already at these Olympic Games. They beat New Zealand on the opening day, and they're still going here against Fiji, the number one seeds. Can they claim another scalp? And then it's Great Britain against South Africa in the second semi-final. So, the first match, just 5 minutes or so away. Brazil, the hosts, against Kenya. Kenya, one of the real disappointments here at these Olympic Games. Ranked number 7 in the world after their performances in the World Rugby World Series this season. But they haven't fired at all. And looking here for their first victory. There's the playing surface. It'll be gone after today. It really has done its job here. It has been a stunning surface. The conditions until yesterday, very good indeed. That wind blowing in the direction of the movement of that camera. That will play some sort of part. Certainly earlier in the day, the pattern over the course of the 6 days of rugby competition is that the wind tends to die down as the day progresses. So by the time we get to the final, which is at 7 o'clock in the evening local time, well, the lights will be on. The sun will have slipped over the hills in the background, and we'll be all set for what should be pretty much perfect conditions. The forecast certainly a lot better than it was yesterday. Brazilian fans, well, they've got behind their team. The women did very well earlier on in the week. The men have struggled a little bit more. But here we can see that squad, including Giuliano Fiori, man who was born and raised in London, qualifies for this Brazil squad by virtue of having a Brazilian father. Daniel Soncri and his twin brother, Philippe, they having transferred their allegiance from France just a few months ago, and they've already been quite a hit with Brazilian rugby at both 15s and 7s. The brothers, Moises Duque and Lucas, well, Lucas the captain, and they are a core of this team, and the Soncri twins and the Duque brothers will both be starting in this match against Kenya. Brothers and even twins, quite a feature of the two sevens competitions, both men's and women's, here in Rio. Several pairs of brothers, sisters and twins. Well, this is how Brazil have done so far. So they waiting for their first victory. Scored the first try in their opening game against Fiji. What a start that was to their tournament. Things tailed off, though, towards the end of that game, as they did against the United States. United States emphatic there. They'd been angered by that opening defeat by the French, and really Brazil caught the backlash there. Argentina, one of the hard luck stories at these Olympic Games, losing out in extra time on the golden point to Great Britain last night. British supporters, well, Great Britain, the newest team here, put together in a matter of weeks from the four home nations. Great Britain into the semi-finals, so very close to a medal. Here are the Kenyans, and they include a couple of the marquee names of the World 7 Series. None more marquee than Collins Ndjira. Nobody has scored more tries in World Rugby Sevens than Collins Ndjira. His elder brother, Humphrey Kayanga, also in this squad, although he won't be starting this opening match on the final day. Well, Well, the fans of Fiji settling themselves in nice and early on what they hope will be a landmark day in their Olympic history. Fiji's first appearance. Well, that happens in around about 2 hours' time when they take on Japan in the first of those medal semi-finals. So this is how Kenya have done. They opened up with a pretty lackluster performance against Great Britain, losing by 31 points to 7. And I have to say, it was a very similar story against New Zealand. And Japan, well, we're at a tail of the tape, boxing style. Japan against Kenya, well, in just about every respect, it would be a mismatch. The Japanese are smaller, they're lighter, man for man, they don't have the same burst of pace, but the Japanese outthought and outplayed them. So the players are moving into the tunnel. We shall acquaint ourselves with the officials here. Alex Ruiz from France, top class referee in France, referees matches in the French top 14. Among the backroom staff, if you like there, Marius van der Vesthuizen, who is one of the assistant referees. A feature of sevens rugby, five on-field officials. An opportunity for the Brazilians to finish off with a flourish in front of their home crowd. The Duque brothers and the Sancri twins both line up in the opening seven here. The coaches do have the opportunity to rotate the squad throughout the match, so they can use all 12 players. The Kenyans, well, they're starting with Collins and Jira, as they have done in every match so far. As if perhaps to try and invite a change in fortunes, the Kenyans here lining up in red. They've been wearing their black jerseys pretty much throughout the tournament so far. Alex Ruiz blows the whistle for the start of the match, the start of finals day. The little chip there coming from Samuel Oliech. And Brazil unable to gather it. Immediately to the hands of Oliech and out wide. This is Odhiambo. Odhiambo, can he get in the corner? Yes, he can. The nod to Alex Ruiz from his in-goal official. And what a fast start. Less than 20 seconds. The restart, untidy from Brazil, falling the way of Kenya. Sweeping it out wide there to Billy Odhiambo, who just powered his way into the corner. Look at him, just drop the shoulder. There's the fend. Power rather than pace, the key that time. So Samuel Oliech will attempt the conversion. Meter in from touch. You could see how that was just held up in the wind. Bit like knocking a wedge on a windy day into the wind by the seaside, that was. The ball almost appearing as if it was coming back at you towards the end. Well, the tackle there by Lucas Duque, the Brazilian captain, insufficient to stop the Kenyan crossing for the score. So Brazil will need to respond and respond quickly. Good hanging restart again. 50-50 ball, again Brazil can't gather it. Looks like it went forward, very similar to the first kick. There's a little chip ahead, and the chase. Back goes Lucas Duque, the captain, doing the sweeping. Opportunity here with Brazil with the ball in hand. Fiori's out wide looking for it. Good break there out of the 22. Kenya unable to take their man down, and when they do, it's high. That's a penalty advantage being played by the referee. Brazil anxious here to show that they're worthy of a place in this dozen. Great work that was from Philippe Sancri. This time it's Daniel Sancri, the twin brother. Fiori there, the first forward on the scene. Good rucking, though, from Kenya. They have turned it. Well, that's where Brazil have been a bit sluggish, at the breakdown. Neat little pass out of the back of the hand. Lucas Duque is hanging back to play sweeper. They don't need a sweeper now. They've won the ball. They've turned it over. Arm is out again from the referee. It'll be a penalty. Well, Alex Ruiz wants it from the mark. Well, that takes something of the vim and the vigour out of the Brazilian attack. Chance now for the Kenyans to regroup, establish their defensive structures. Felipe Sonkari made an immediate impact when he arrived in Brazil a little more than 6 months ago. Scored 3 tries for the 15s team in the Americas Championship. Brazil recording a remarkable 15s win in that event against the United States. Lucas Duque getting himself in a bit of a fix there, but Brazil have kept hold of it. There it is with Moises Duque. Here is Fiore again, played in a Varsity match, that traditional game between Oxford and Cambridge University. That was 9 years ago. Fiore played for Cambridge, and Cambridge won. Here goes Moises Duque, out to Kouwe, Bergo, back the other way, Fiore again. The defensive line for Kenya, not moving swiftly, but steadily in formation, forcing the Brazilians back. They too have got a sweeper back of Kenya, just creating a second line of defense. Brazil unable to fashion a way through. Maybe they are now. The gap closed very swiftly indeed. Referee's got his arm up. Penalty advantage again. Last 2.5 minutes of the first seven. Kenya leading by 5 points to 0. You can see from that slow motion picture just how ferocious the hits are here. This is a format of the game which tends to be associated with speed of hand and fast runners, but physicality is involved. Oh, great little touch that time, coming from the captain, Lucas Duque, swiftly through the hands, taking it from the right, feeding it to the left. There goes Kouwe onto Fiore. Now a suggestion of a 2-on-1 here, out from Felipe Sonkari. That's his brother. Oh, but it's been turned by Kenya, but they have taken it into touch. Well, just for a moment, it appeared as if the Sonkari twins were themselves single-handedly going to create the opening and execute the score, but defense was good from Kenya. But Brazil have a chance here. Let's see how their line-out works. Well, the Kenyans have advantage here in terms of inches at the line-out. Brazil's jumper is Alta Bergo, wearing 10. Andrew Amonde just having one or two matters of law run past him by Alex Ruiz. Last 90 seconds, clock's running. Can they get this set piece right? It's begun a four-man line out. Fiore rises high. Only got a finger to it. It went in the wrong direction. Kenya bursting away here. Final minute. Well picked up there. There was patience involved there from Kenya. Bit of a looping pass. That's Mbaka. Powerful. Got through the first line of defence. Not the second, though. Excellent tackle from Felipe Sonkari. Brazil doing well to slow the ball down there. Back goes Andrew Amonde. Up comes the defence. Now can they cut him down? There's the little inside pass. It's left for the sweeper, and the sweeper has missed him. And this is going to be a second Kenyan try. And just coasting in is Billy Odhiambo. Well, he's not even coasting. He's walking. The sun is bright. And Kenya, at long last, of putting together some sort of performance. Well, Amonde it was who started it. There's a little inside pass. It's now for the sweeper to tackle him. But I'm afraid Odhiambo just outpaced him. 10-0. And 10 becomes 12. Half-time in the opening match on finals day. And it's Kenya who lead Brazil by 12 points to nil. The Kenyan coach is Benjamin Ayimba. Well, let's just look back at those two scores. This one coming in the first half minute. A good kick to start the game. Turned it into a 50-50 ball. Brazil unable to gather it. And in the end, it was just the power that got him home. The captain comes across, Lucas Duque, but unable to make the tackle. And this time, well, I'm afraid it was Duque again, playing sweeper, but unable to apprehend Billy Odhiambo. So Andres Romagnoli. Romagnoli, the Spanish speaker from Argentina, former Pumas sevens coach, played fly half for the Pumas in 15s. And working here with the Portuguese-speaking Brazilians. So which of these two will finish 11th in the Olympic Sevens competition? Kenya in command at the moment. They lead by 12 points to nil. Can Brazil just put in a performance to delight their fans who've come here? And they really have been quite vociferous in their support of their team. But at the moment, it has yet to drive them onto a victory. That was an excellent catch under a high ball. And Brazil now playing into bit of a breeze. There goes Fiore. Make good meters, the big fella. Arm is out from the referee. That's a penalty advantage. You wait to see if it comes. It doesn't. Off goes Lucas Duque. But the referee wants it back from the mark. And every time that happens, it allows the defending side to reorganize. There's the kick. Oh, caught Bushamwala on the back of the head. Got caught in the wind of the ball, and Amwala lost it. He eventually found it, or should I say the ball found him. Good tackle from Fiore. Kenya have it. There's a Kenyan down, so effectively they're down to six men at the moment. But they might not need anybody else, because look at this break from William Mbaka. And Mbaka, well, he's just going to jog in. Well, the Brazilians have given their all over the course of 3 days. But this would appear to be 14 minutes too far for them. William Mbaka, try number three for Kenya. Both these teams just trying to salvage some sort of pride after a pretty disappointing 2 days before it. The Kenyans particularly ranked seventh in the World Rugby Seven Series, and they would have expected certainly to have made the top eight here at the very least. Well, some people predicting very close to that touchline. Stick anything on that touchline when you got the ball in hand and the flags go up. And there's the attempt at the conversion. Bit snap hooky. Wide of the left hand upright, but Kenya in control. 17 points to nil now, 5 minutes to go. Opening game on the final day, finals day at the Deodoro Stadium. Semi-finals to come in around about 2 hours' time. Mouth-watering prospects they are. Fiji in the first of those semi-finals against Japan. Then it's Great Britain against South Africa. Ball lost forward by Brazil. Alex Ruiz has blown his whistle. Scrum down, Kenya ball. They really have had problems with the restarts of Brazil. Down on one knee there, Samuel Oliech. Into the hands there of Biko Adema. That's Collins and Jera. Let's see a bit of magic from the great man. Good offload. Nice little step. And that will be another score. Well, they have something called unopposed rugby, which forms part of most captains' runs in the 15s format. This is the nearest equivalent you get in sevens rugby. Very one-sided indeed. Unopposed rugby, when you go through one or two practice drills with no opposition. Billy Odhiambo, well, only operating there in third gear. There's a little burst of pace. There's a step, bouncing off the tackler and the offload. Big step on the right foot. And another try for Odhiambo, who's rather enjoying this third day. Conversion is good. Kenya well into the 20s now. These Olympic Games have generated some super images. Both televisual and photographic. I saw an image last night taken by a photographer called Dave Rogers, who caught in perfect synchronicity two British players leaning down to console two Argentinian foes. After that classic game last night, which went to extra time, it was 0-0, and then we saw the golden point coming from Great Britain. And in just one image, it suitably summed up the previous 20 minutes or so of action. Here's Lucas Duque. Argentina, or should I say Brazil, throwing in all their replacements here. Oh, that was a deliberate knock-on there from Kenya. Referee playing the advantage. Through goes Albuquerque. On to Giantono. Giantono looking all around. Where's the support? His right foot goes into touch. The volume level increased. The sense there that maybe Brazil could conjure something, but in the end it came to nothing. Good work in defence by Collins and Jera. The last 100 seconds of both these teams' Olympic campaigns. And Jera misses his man. Just finds Kue, and Kue, oh, he didn't back himself, but the chance may still come. It does for Stefano Giantono, but the referee has seen a knock-on. The applause will subside to groans. Oh, we thought he was there. It came loose, that's where it was forward. Alex Ruiz, absolutely correct. Alteration being made here by Brazil. On comes Philippe Sonkeri, he'll replace Stefano Giantono. So, 5 metre scrum. Collins and Jera playing scrum half here for Kenya. And Jera with the put in. Well defended there by Brazil, but Kenya still emerged from the ruck with it. Let's see if we can see one final bit of magic here. Penalty advantage being played to Kenya. Last 10 seconds. There's Kayanga. Well, the offload is loose. Maybe it'll be the Brazilians. There's the hooter. Let's see if Brazil can do something here. Would be a bit special to at least finish. Oh, high tackle, we're coming back. There was no advantage from the penalty. Alex Ruiz rather halting Brazil's attempt to take the ball quickly. And Duque getting himself caught. That's Moises Duque, little chip ahead, he's gathered it. He's got the offload away. Brazil have got the score. Alex Ruiz thinks it's gone forward for the second time. Brazil are denied. And you know that bit I was saying about images crystallising the moment? Well, that was it. So near, but yet so far. It's this pass here. That's the one that went forward. The referee was absolutely correct. Kenya have claimed 11th spot. They've beaten Brazil by 24 points to nil. Brazil's campaign on home turf comes to an end.
Weather conditions couldn't be much better. Lovely conditions for this final day here at Deodora Stadium with Sevens Rugby underway, the last two sessions here on day three. So there's the record of the United States team as they get ready to come out for the next game against Spain. They've rather disappointed by their high standards, but we'll see how they go in this battle that they're going to have against the Spanish in this playoff game for 9th and 10th place. So there's the USA rugby banner to the left. Lots of flags and banners around the ground as we look at the Spanish squad, which has come here. They've had some injury problems as well. They had to make some late changes to their lineup. And indeed, Pablo Fontes has come into their starting seven for this game. He's a replacement player. And there is their record. They had that win over Kenya by 14 points to 12, which means they've come up to play off here in this game for 9th and 10th. High hopes for Spanish rugby. That'd be a good result if they could get up to 9th, considering they were the last team to qualify for these men's rugby sevens. Well, the craziness of the Sevens dress-up world has reached Rio de Janeiro, and the fans are really getting into it here. The referee for this one is the familiar figure of Rasta Rasavengi, and also familiar Matt O'Brien, Craig Joubert, Ricardo Santana, and the fifth is Enrique Platé. The in-goal judges, both from Brazil, a great compliment and encouragement to refereeing of rugby in Brazil. But here comes USA to play the Spanish team as we look down and check the starting lineup of the USA team. You see down the bottom there, number 13, Martin Josefo, has come in as a new player replacing Perry Baker. So that's a disappointment for the fans who'd like to see the long running style at high speed of the man they call the speed stick, Perry Baker, but he's out injured. However, if you want to see speed, stay tuned. Carlin Isles, number one, is playing. So USA onto the field to play Spain in this game on the third and final day. It's the final appearance for these two teams at Rio 2016, a playoff for 9th and 10th ranking. So there is Martin Josefo, as referee Rasta Rasavangi kicks off. Yosefa coming into the USA team. He didn't play on the first or second day. And let's see how this one unfolds with the Spanish team being brought forward here by Matias Tudela. And the referee, you hear him calling advantage for offside. Out wide, it's Angel Lopez, number five. Good, energetic start by Spain. Taking the ball wide. Very good loop-the-loop. And running hard for them, Javier Carrion. So that's a good start for Spain. These two ranking matches on the third and final day are for the lesser teams, but straight after this, we go back into the teams that made the quarterfinals and were disappointed to miss out, and they play off for the higher rankings, but out of the medals. So, for instance, the next game on is New Zealand against France. Meantime, Spain showing plenty against USA, and that's Marcelo Poggi. He's had a very good tournament. 5 meters out. This is the new man in the team, Pablo Fontes, who's come in as well from the reserves. And Pablo is in for the first try, greeted warmly by his teammates. Welcome to being an Olympian. Did well, didn't he? He's been close to the team all season, and obviously not far away when the first 2 days of this competition were held, but was brought in because of injury to make their squad of 12 today, and gets the first try. So in fact, the two number 13s there involved, Martin Yosefa, not making a great contribution in defense as the little man Fontes came at him very quickly, and just too quickly, in fact. So at last, USA get their hands on the ball. Well, a yellow card has been issued. So that charge by the Spanish player Losada was called deliberate by referee Rasavangi, and so he went down in some sort of injury, but when he got up, he had to get out. Yellow carded, so USA 7-on-6 now. Here they go with their first foray into Spanish territory. Hughes, Yosefo, Cardinals, the speedster. The excitement always amps up when he gets the ball. It also amps up when there's tackles like that. Here comes USA now. Yosefo is passed this time to, oh, the big man is in, Danny Barrett. Waving up to the crowd. Look at him, what a monster he is. He makes these roller coaster runs and is famous for them in American sevens rugby circles. That one, not such a great example of it, but very effective. Catch the ball, take it hard at the opposition, beat the defenders and head in for the try. Scored by Danny Barrett. And there's the acknowledgement to his fans. Conversion coming from Madison Hughes. It's over, and USA take the lead by 7-5. So the kickoff coming here from Falau Niua. again. Spain straight into their work. Remember that wonderful story about how they qualified to be at the Olympic Games. The fans of Samoan Sevens must be watching this with a little bit of chagrin, because somebody's hurt down there. It's the grasp of pain. Tough tackling. It's a head high. There is a player still down for Spain. Might be just winded. Slow to get up. Now that is Marcus Poggi. There is the man who scored the try, Danny Barrett. He's a full professional from USA Rugby, an old boy of the University of UC Cal at Berkeley. Along with Garrett Bender, they're called the Bash Brothers. Barrett and Bender, the Bash Brothers. So here's Fontes throwing. He clears it now nicely away to Genoa. Again, Spanish having plenty of good moments. What does the referee say about that block? He says it's okay. The ball is in touch. If you're new to watching rugby sevens, the tackles have to have arms in them. You can't just charge in and block a player. You must have your arms to wrap around the torso or the legs of a player. You can't go anywhere near the head. You can have one arm or two, but you can't go near the head, and you can't charge without your arms. Something like that is the colloquial description. There is Josefo. Here is Carlin Isles. Look at this. Look at this from the Olympic sprinter, the man who's done 10.13. And here he goes. Touches the ball, and 70 meters downfield, he salutes his own try. Carlin Isles saw the game played on television a few years ago, liked what he saw. He was an American footballer. And so he rang up and said, can I try out to US rugby? And they said, sure, we'd like to have a look at you. And here he is. And that's the kind of form he's brought to USA Sevens excitement. So halftime has been reached. USA lead by 12-5. One, two, three, four, five, I can hear myself, yes. getting set for the second half of USA in the white and blue against Spain in the yellow and blue shorts. USA leading by 12-5. This is a playoff for the 9th and 10th places. Obviously disappointments for both of these nations in being in this situation, especially, may I say, the USA team, who many considered with their great speed in their squad that they might do even better than where they are now, or much better than where they are now, but it hasn't worked out that way. Meantime, the Spanish have hopes of perhaps a 9th place. They get it to Podgy, but it's ruled forward, is it? Yes, it's ruled forward by the referee. This is all not happening, because as you see the referee away to the right, he says forward pass. We can have a look along the line here. It's a pretty tight call. Bit of disappointment for Spain. Marcus Podgy, bit of handbags from Carlin Isles, but he got him down in the end. Madison Hughes, the USA captain, such a fine player. And there's a high ball to midfield to Falau Niua. Hughes again, Josefa very strong and quick. Carlin Isles, he's got one. Runs out of speed, runs out of ground there as he speeds to the sideline. Big hit in midfield. Now, here comes the man that got the try, Danny Barrett. Referee's going back for a late tackle. The referee's going to take time off. And substitutes, that's why he's taking time off. Substitutes will come into the game. Four of them coming on. 1, 4, 7, and 3. Must be a nightmare for the referees when you think about it, with four coming on for the Spanish on that side. And I think it was two or three on the United States team. That's half of the previous game suddenly altered. Now, let's see Spain trying to build it up from the back. They're within touch of the USA score. They take it to the right now. Igor Genoa. Now here's Iggy Martin. He's been one of their great players over the years. And now it's with Javier Carrion. This is good. Matias Tudela. Lovely. Excellent carrying on by Lopez. And the try is scored by Angel Lopez. Oh, look at that beautiful rolling one-handed pass, and another one from the Spanish team showing some real tricky stuff. And finally, it was the 24-year-old Lopez from Cisneros in Madrid. Over he goes for the try. He's going to be a doctor when all this is put behind him. He's a medical student now, but obviously concentrating on his rugby sevens. The kick is over. It's 12 all in this one. 3 minutes to play. Situation desperate now for USA. Well, for both teams, but USA in particular. A team with a big reputation. Zach Test goes in, taps it to himself. Veteran of the tour. Getting it out wide. Maka Yunufe is into the game. And Chris Wiles, most accomplished player from the United States and then playing in Europe as well. And this time they're trying to find Yusefo out wide. And this time it's gone into Wilds again. Seems to be moving pretty well, the veteran. And Yusefo, 10 meters out. They take it to the left. And it's going to be a comfortable try for Maka Yunufe. Well, I say he's pretty quick as well. Doesn't quite have the reputation of Baker and Isles, but a well-taken try there by Maka Yunufe. And a good kick too from Madison Hughes to make it 19-12 now to USA. So there's Ben Pinkelman as Hughes kicks off. Just a minute to go in a bit. Martin, Spain, trying to come from long distance and get into this. Tudela, there is the little man, Genoa. That's Paul Pla, is it? Fontes still down there, number 13. Well, way across on the far side, Zach Test is remonstrating with one of the assistants in the game, and I don't think Zach wants to go off the field. The assistant there is suggesting that he might go for a concussion test, perhaps. Let's look. This is very significant now in rugby union, awareness of the need for tests for head injuries and concussion. There's a lot of collision in the game. And he's a tough man, is Test, and he won't want to go off. And he was sort of tussling and trying to shrug off the attendant. And now the teammates have persuaded him, and he's persuaded himself to go off for the concussion test. So there's hardly any time left. So that's rather a sad end to the Olympic program of Zach Test. But meantime, the game goes on with USA trying to put one more on the board. So they get it to Carlin Isles. And he skips away from the defense. Coming in on him is Cesar Sempere. And look at this from big Andrew Duritalo. And at last, given the half chance from Duritalo, it's going to be Carlin Isles who flashes and flourishes one last time for USA. And wasn't that done well? He realized himself he wasn't going to get through. He's lighter of frame than Duritalo, who's a monster, one of the biggest guys in the World Cup. And so he took the tackles and then rolled the pass to Isles, who showed a clean pair of heels to get through and score. Wonderful work by the USA, the big man and the speedster. And maybe the promise of what USA could have shown us. Hughes kicked from wide out. It has missed. The game is over. And look how close he was to the sideline. But that's a wonderful shot of flying feet. And they belong to Carlin Isles. He's been billed for the last couple of seasons as the fastest man in rugby. He could have gone to the Olympic Games if he'd trained hard for the 100-meter sprint, because he had the qualification times under his belt. But he's stuck with rugby, and Perry Baker is equally as fast. It's a bit of a debate as to who is quicker, but his, without Baker, who was injured today, USA, in their last showing, brought Carlin Isles into the game, and that was a move that the fans and the team loved, because he's helped them with his tries to a win over Spain and a ninth place by 24-12. So there in the match stats, 4-2 to USA. Big thanks from all the players of both teams to their supporters in the crowds, easily identified by recognizing their flags. And all part of a great arrival of women's and men's sevens into the Olympic program. So that's the last we'll see of those four teams at this Olympic Games: Brazil, Kenya, USA, and Spain. They've played off their ranking games, and now the other remaining teams will play off for, first of all, ranking games and then the medal matches. And that's the kind of spirit we've had here at Deodoro. And there goes Mike Friday. Little bit of a rueful look on his face. Not the position he'd like to have finished in. And look at that. This is what it's all about. The camaraderie between rugby players on the field is, well, it's rivalry on the field, but off the field it's fantastic. And there are the two men, Ignacio Martin and Carlin Isles. They've been around the tour for the last couple of years playing against each other, but more than that, it's traveling together as groups, the teams. They go from city to city and staying in the same hotel. It's breakfast, lunch, and dinner in those hotels, in the elevators going upstairs, etc., etc. So friendships are made, and lovely friendships are confirmed. Here's the USA team. Take your photo of the team, USA, that finished in ninth place and gave us some of the best rugby here. Well played, and well played to Spain, who had that qualifying match against Samoa and only just squeaked it in Monaco to get here, and they played bravely and finish in 10th place. So here we are at Deodoro Stadium in Rio, where the conditions on the third and final day still lovely to watch rugby. Couldn't really be better. Whatever the temperature says, at 21 degrees, it's cooled nicely by a breeze that's coming in across the field, and the flags reflecting that. Field has held up brilliantly for six consecutive days of rugby sevens, and there we are getting set for New Zealand against France. That's the match that is coming to you next here from the Deodoro Stadium. It's a men's placing match for positions 5 to 8. That's the best that any of the teams can hope for from this point that are playing in this game and the next. Is to be fifth. It's a kind of semi-final, this one, between New Zealand and France, and to follow will be Australia against Argentina. And the winners of the two games will then play off against each other for, hopefully for them, a fifth place finish. So that's the best they can hope for in the tough world of Olympic sevens. These teams, of course, all came here hoping for gold. New Zealand had high expectations, but they've lost a couple of players. And they're down to about 10 in their squad, even though 12 are listed there. They lost Sonny Bill Williams. They also lost Scott Curry and Joe Weber. So effectively, they lost three. And so there's their record as it stands at the moment. And as Gordon Titchen said yesterday, one win out of four games at this competition, simply not good enough. And there's the horror run for New Zealand, reflected perhaps in the horror run of injuries as well. But the Kiwi fans who've made the long trek to be here are still here, and obviously hoping for a flourish here against France. There is the French squad, and you see that on the right-hand side at the bottom, they've listed number 13 player, which is indication that they too have bought in a replacement player for this day. Sofiane Guiton is the replacement player. There's the French record. Well, they've had two wins and two losses. The key loss for them was the one against Spain. And against Japan. The one against Japan put the Japanese through to shock the sevens world, but then the Japanese can say proudly that they've beaten both the teams that are in this next matchup, because on day one they beat New Zealand as well. And there is Thierry Bourouahua, who is the captain of the French sevens team, nervously waiting in the corridor. The referee is Federico Anselmi, Anthony Moyes and Taku Otsuki, Matt O'Brien and Ben Krauss. There's that wonderful shot of the teams running out into the beautiful weather here in Rio. This is New Zealand against France, a semi-final for the playoff for fifth to eighth position. And in the New Zealand starting seven, you can see that Gillies Kaka, number eight, is starting, and Augustine Pulu, who did start in some other recent games, is not there. And I just wonder whether the bangs that he suffered yesterday makes him added to the list of injuries, which means if that's the case, New Zealand goes into the game with only nine players. We shall see. They've made no official comment about it. We checked the starting French lineup as well. But this has got to be a very difficult and awkward game to play in this one and the one that follows for Australia in their matchup against Argentina, because these were the teams that lost and had their high hopes of medals taken out in the previous round. So they've got to come out and play these, shall we say, disappointment games for their countries. And there's Julien Candelon, the oldest player in any of the teams here at the Rio Games, as Gilles Kaka kicks off for New Zealand against France in the semi-finals for the two matches to find the 5th to 8th placing rankings. So, New Zealand, we know their strengths and we know their weaknesses. They don't have blistering speed. The French probably have more speed than the New Zealand team, but these guys know each other well. They've played against each other a number of times. The first blast on the whistle from referee from Argentina, Federico Anselmi. It's a penalty for France. And there is Buruahua. Now there is the first call on a head-high tackle by Rico Ioane. Now they're tough on head-high tackles. And Ioane got one yesterday that had him in the bin for a while. So the New Zealanders finding out the hard way that anything high-ish can count against them. Buruahua. Jeremy Icardi. New Zealand have possession. Here goes Kaka. He's got Mickelson with him. Tim Mickelson, the veteran. Presents it, plants it nicely for Kaka again. Akira Ioane. Regan Ware. He's always got nice side steps, Ware. Now it's 3 versus 2 out wide. And look at this from DJ Forbes. He's not known as a man to bust up the centre, but he had it go there. And now it's with Akira Ioane using power, pushing it off, gives it to Ware, and Regan Ware scores the first try of the match. It's gone to New Zealand, and the Waikato man, Regan Ware, has scored it. Here it comes. Look at this from Forbes. Using an indication that he means business when he's shaved off the beard from the previous day. And that was a real aggressive run by him. And nice work by Akira Ioane to allow Regan Ware to waltz it in. Conversion is just wide from Kaka, but New Zealand into the lead by 5-0. Kaka kicks off. Over there on the far side, it's Jonathan Logel, the guy in the nickname Rabbi. That's Stephen Perez. Buruahua. Coming up the halfway now. French swing on to attack. Candelon. Candelon, lovely run. Beautiful play by Candelon. Gives it to Perez. And Stephen Perez in under the posts. Well-constructed try by France. Have a look at this from the 36-year-old. He's carried the hopes in his mind of becoming an Olympian, and he knew that he'd have to be 36 years of age before he got her. There he goes. Candle, as they call him, made the run, delivered a beautiful pass, and his teammate, wow, he's 21, so he's 15 years younger. And in goes Stephen Perez. Nice conversion from Buruahua, and that's France into the lead by 7-5. There's French coach Frederic Pomerel. High kickoff, lots of hang time, but good leap. Did it landed on the shoulder of Sam Dixon. Fumble. Not gone forward according to referee Anselmi. So the man that got the try, Perez, starts another move. Lugel, Candelon. Candelon meets Mickelson and Dixon. But it's presented there. And that's a penalty against Mickelson, not releasing. Here is the man who got the try a minute ago, Perez. It's 20 metres out. New Zealand moving it again. Sending it wide this time to Icardi. Candelon. And he's bounced Dixon. Penalty against New Zealand, number four. It was Forbes was offside there. And now here's France looking dangerous with Manuel Deligne. You can hear the grunts and the groans and the bones crack in there. It's such tough hitting and lost forward by New Zealand. So tough first half. Looks like a substitute, is it? Of France, Pierre-Gilles Lacafia. And leaving the field is Damien Clair. So it's a blood bin against Sam Dixon. He's leaving the field to be sorted out. Gee, that's quite a gash, isn't it? My word, what a cut that is. As we say, down under, a lot of claret. Or maybe these days we'll say a lot of Pinot Noir. Either way, the French would understand what I'm talking about. So here's Thierry Brouwer. With 40 seconds to go in the first half, France in the lead, 7-5. Candelon, the man who has waited decades to be an Olympian, puts his hand over his heart. And what they've called this, a no try, lost forward. So there's a disappointment for Candelon, the great man. This is called a forward pass. Look at it coming from Perez. Yes, reached out. And while he finished it with a flourish and made a lovely gesture, it was called a forward pass. And the French said, you have awarded the try. The touch judge, as we call them, had his flag up. So the French inquired who was controlling the game. So New Zealand now trying to muscle their way out of their own 22. And the hand went on the ball in there. New Zealand are conceding far too many penalties. And he played it on the ground, Rico Ioane. And so have France got a move that can construct a try before the halftime comes? There's the siren for halftime. Nicely delayed, then passed out. And the pass goes to Perez, and he's in again. He's in for his second. Some gaps appeared in the New Zealand defence, which are quite shocking to New Zealand rugby. And the French worked a very fine move there. Well worked with Icardi to Perez, and that's his second try. So too many mistakes and big holes in the New Zealand team at the moment, and France deservedly in the lead at the break by 12-5. Buruaha speaking there. Now the voice of Frederick Pomerel. That was excellent run by DJ Forbes. Good presentation. Nice work here by Akira Iwane. And then rolling the pass. And there was no pressure on Regan Ware. But then France came back. Stephen Perez, two tries. That's the first one with the conversion. That put them in the lead. And then just before halftime, taken to the left was Icardi. And then he turned it back inside to the same try scorer, Perez, who scored his second. Second half begins, or has it? The referee said, I never said to start. They just decided to go ahead. Now they'll wait for referee Anselmi from Argentina. There's the signal to start the second half. France are leading by 12-5 over New Zealand. You see the big headband there over Sam Dixon. They've covered up that gash on his forehead. He won't be recognizable when he gets back to West Melton in New Zealand. Goodness. So Kaka throws. Dixon goes high. Kaka now passing into the backs. Gone past Ware to Akira Iwane. And this will be a long run. Been chased by Buruaha, but it's the long and short of it. And did he get it down? The signal comes in, and a try scored by Akira Iwane. Let's have a look at that. He just bust the center. Buruaha is way, way shorter than him, but he gave it a brave chase. And look at this squabbling at the end and then put it down. The ball did kind of roll forward, but was after the try had been properly scored. Shifts the ball to the other arm to make the fend. That's the way it's done. And full marks to Terry Buruaha. According to the stats, he weighs 65 kgs and Akira Iwane weighs 105. So it was a kind of a mismatch, but full marks to Buruaha for giving it a go. So the try is unconverted. France still have the lead. 12-10. New Zealand penalized yet again for not a quick enough release. And that's the pass going wide for Manuel Dalinha through Candelon. Outright to Virimi Vakatawa. And that was a very nice push ahead. He's come off the bench, and it could have been curtains if that had bounced in field. So Virimi Vakatawa, the big star of French sevens, and then switched over to the 15s, and now back to the sevens, is into the game. And he is a formidable force on the French side for these last 4 minutes. Where? Rico Iwane. He's having a go. Chased by Vakatawa, who simply hasn't got the speed to match the young man from New Zealand. Well, that is interesting. So the Ioane brothers in consecutive tries, touchdown for New Zealand. Look at this. Vakatawa just didn't have it. Fair dues to him. It's not his strength. He's a power player, not a speed man, whereas this man is considerably quicker. And Rico matched his brother with a lovely run. And that's a very good try by the youngest member of the New Zealand squad. Let's have a look at this kick. And a beauty by Gillies Kaka. So New Zealand now in the lead by 17-12. Remember, they're playing for a place in a final to decide who will finish fifth at these Olympic Games. It's nothing more than that for the two teams, because they lost in the knockout quarterfinals 24 hours ago. Now here's a new resolve in the New Zealand team. They got down there quickly and crowded the French defense, and they've won the right to the put-in. Buruahua again. Very light. New Zealanders, big numbers, got there quickly. There's Lewis Ormond, who's into the game. So what can New Zealand from a set play here organize? Kaka with the ball, behind him is Buruahua. Short ball. Regan Ware gets his second. Bit of a heavy thump for Regan as well. Two tries in this game for him. Three for the Olympic Games program. And did he fall heavily here as he scored it? Yeah, somebody came down heavily on him. And the kick is over. So New Zealand now leading by 24-12. And so that's Regan Ware subbed off. And new player onto the field for New Zealand is number 13, Sione Molia. There he is. And there is Gus Pulu, who's on. Two men from the proud rugby school of South Auckland and counties area of New Zealand, counties Manukau area, Wesley College, both on the field at the same time. Wesley College, of course, produced Jonah Lomu, who played a big part in getting this sport to these Olympic Games. Went and met with the International Olympic Committee as part of the rugby delegation, and they were successful. Jonah was part of that, much missed, of course. But his old school is represented here by Pulu and Molia. And there is Pulu. The school, incidentally, had so many guys in the Rugby World Cup for 15s last year that they could nearly have fielded a full team across four countries: New Zealand, Fiji, Tonga, and Samoa. So time has run out here on the French hopes. And New Zealand in the lead by 24-12. Again, another penalty. So France now running it out to Buruahua, out to Steve Barry. Good tackle on him by Rico Ioane. Flung away by Logel. Candelon floats it wide to Vakatawa. Where's the New Zealand defense? Well in control of the big man. And this might well be the end of the game. it is released, though, for the French, and they've got it. And well played by Sacha Vallot, who gets a try. Off the subs bench, when it looked like the game might end with a scrum award there, it suddenly popped out on the French side. And Sacha Vallot, this young man who went to the Youth Olympic Games in Nanjing 2 years ago and played there, he's one of a very few who did that. He won a gold medal there with the French sevens team. And he scored the last try for them here 2 years on at the Summer Olympics here in Rio. So that's a fine moment for Vallot. And the last kick is over. It's 24-19, the final score. But the men in black of New Zealand progress through to the final matchup for the battle for the fifth place ranking. And France will play again in the battle for seventh or eighth. But this one has been won by New Zealand. A better performance by New Zealand, and they've won it by 24-19. They scored 4-3 along the way.
Well, it's not full, but there's a very good crowd here building for the final day of this sevens competition. And now the second of those playoff games as we determine the sides that will finish fifth, sixth, seventh and eighth. It's Argentina against Australia. Argentina, I guess the big question to be asked there is, can they pick themselves up after the bitter disappointment of missing out on going into the last four when they, it went all the way to extra time against Great Britain last night before Dan Bibby crossed for the try, which claimed the golden point and condemned Argentina to this side of the draw, or this group within the draw, instead of going on to the semi-finals. So Argentina against Australia, two familiar foes in the 15s format, both members of the Rugby Championship quartet, which kicks off pretty shortly, actually, after this Olympic competition. And there are a couple of players in this Argentinian squad who are full Argentina internationals and have featured very prominently in recent times. Matias Moroni and Juan Imhoff, who both scored tries in that famous World Cup quarterfinal win for the Pumas against Ireland under the roof in Cardiff back in October. Well, this is how Argentina have progressed so far. Two wins out of four. They started off with that win against the United States of America, which really was very timely indeed and played its part in propelling Argentina to the quarterfinals and condemning the United States to compete for one of the bottom four slots, something which the Americans never properly recovered from. As for Australia, I guess you could say the same. They lost their opening game against France and they were playing catch up, and despite the win against South Africa on the second morning of competition, they never really again properly got over that setback early on, and they were condemned to a quarter-final draw against the South Africans. And with a little more intensity in their game, the South Africans won that in the end quite comfortably. So this is the Australia squad. Includes Ed Jenkins, Australia's most capped sevens international ever. Cameron Clark, who just shines season after season on the sevens circuit. They have lost one player along the way, Lewis Holland, who was pulled out of the Australia squad after the second round of matches. That was the first evening, suffering from a hamstring strain. His position went to Tom Kingston. So this is Australia's progression through the opening 2 days. That first time defeat by France that they never recovered from, really. It was a heavy defeat, and though they did atone for it with that win against South Africa, they then went on to be knocked out of the quarterfinals. Well, there, that was a sporting gesture from Gaston Revol, the captain of the Argentina side, just exchanging pleasantries with Ed Jenkins, his opposite number. Marius van der Westhuizen of South Africa is the referee for this. His two assistants, Rasta Rasavinga, and also there with him is Alex Ruiz of France. So the winner of this earns the opportunity to play off for fifth place later on in the day. There is the starting seven, and it includes Gaston Revol, the captain, and Axel Muller, who's been one of the stars here. Axel Muller, who after this tournament will be moving to the south of France to join Murat Boujalal's Toulon, the Galacticos of world rugby. Jesse Parahy, well, he's had a few journeys of his own in recent months. Took a break from sevens rugby to try and crack it at NRL, the rival code league, but returned in time to make this seven squad for the Olympic Games. So Marius van der Westhuizen just checking with the captain of the Australia team, Ed Jenkins, that they're set to go. It will be Argentina in their traditional blue and white hoops. And there's the first kick from Gaston Revol. Very cultured little dab with a bit of hang time on it, but it's not enough to prevent Australia to get possession. Cameron Clark, they're feeding out to Fa'alava'au, one of the Australians who has yet to score in this Olympic Games competition. There's Parahy. Parahy just trying to step inside the inside shoulder of the Argentinian. Stannard onto Cameron Clark. Jenkins is looking for it. Well, good defensive work again that time from the Argentina captain, Gaston Raval. Well, it's turned over again. Australia have it. Paravaal, Stannard. Picking it up, there was Tom Cusack, who's really impressed, and he's done it again through two tackles, and he gets the first try of this match, and less than a minute on the clock. Yes, it's been a mixed bag from Australia at this tournament. Not so from Tom Cusack, though. He's had a very good tournament indeed. Well, the conversion, straightforward enough. There is the try scorer. Made his Games debut at the Commonwealth Games in Glasgow 2 years ago. So James Stannard goes for distance this time. Straight down the throw to the captain, Raval. There goes Estelez, back to Raval. Oh, and he's dumped down. Now, that tackle was very, very close to the line, and you can see how Gaston Raval just pleading there, but Parahi is off and running. And on there to Cusack, and it's a second score. So two out of two for Tom Cusack. The quick thinking from Jesse Parahi. Four tries now in the tournament for Cusack. Argentina, I think, were still bleating about the tackle. Cusack took no time in taking advantage with the assistance of that man, Jesse Parahi. Really aggressive ball carrier. And he returned to the sevens game from his NRL experiment in April. So two out of two. Not from the kicking tee, but with the drop goal conversion. Australia 14 points to the good. Heading as things stand for a trans-Tasman battle for fifth spot. Palm back. On to Raval again. Just looking for some support behind him, though. There's a little pop pass. Straight into a wall of green and gold, though. Look at Cusack there at the breakdown. Hands in the ruck, says the referee. So Argentina, well, they are the most passionate group of supporters, I think, at this tournament, along with the Brazilians. So Gaston Raval, Argentina back in their set piece. That's why Raval just drifting across field. Onto that too, that was Escura, drifting across field, Alvarez. Well, you could certainly hear that crunching hit where I'm sitting. I'm sure the table shook as well. Off and running here is Estelez. Good work. This time it's to Axel Muller, the man on his way to Toulon. Raval, now here's him off. Chance here perhaps over on the left-hand side. Good, intricate handwork there. Escura. Oh, and then an Australian hand gets in and it's perhaps four against two. Maybe that was a little too complicated there to Cusack. Inside to Parahi. Parahi's repelled, but there are simply too many jerseys here at the moment. And now there's space here for Cusack. Imhoff is coming across, but it's two on one. On to Jenkins. Stannard's there as well if he needs him. Imhoff gets back. Great work in defence from the Puma. Penalty advantage. Argentina slowing it down at the breakdown. There may well be a yellow card. Indeed there is. Juan Imhoff. Well, he knew what was coming, did Juan Imhoff. him off already. A top 14 champion this year with Racing 92 in Paris. Sure, Jackie Lorenzetti will have half an eye on this tournament. He wants his Puma back in one piece for the start of the French top 14 season, which gets underway in the next 10 days or so. There's Confoli. Foley through the gap. Little skip and a step. It's all it took. 19-0, soon to become 21. Yeah, well, on the evidence of the first 2 days, Argentina much the stronger of these two sides. I posed the question at the start, I wondered if that defeat last night in extra time, the golden point, condemning Argentina to this group of four rather than the four competing for the medals. I wondered if psychologically they would be able to come back from it, and the answer has been no. A very flat Argentinian performance at the moment. Estelés off and running. He'll need some help here because Stannard's coming across. He showed him the touchline, but Stannard couldn't get hold of him. What a great tackle that was, though, from Pat McCutcheon. Great scrambling defence. Here's Revol. There are more green and gold jerseys over there as well. That was Luna. Oh, well, Argentina have lost their bite, haven't they? Little knock forward there from Australia. There comes the half-time hooter, but the referee, Marius van der Vesthuizen, just reminding both players that he called for the scrum before the hooter. Well, James Stannard there had showed the touchline to Estelés. Stannard missed him, but Pat McCutcheon just grabbed hold of a bootlace and hung on for dear life. 21 points to nil to Australia. Andy Friend, the Australia coach, will be saying if only they could have produced this right at the start of the tournament. Well, now at long last, Argentina have got themselves off the mark. Gaston Revol. He's been a World Series Sevens player for more than 7 years. Knows the game inside out. May have one or two more athletic players around than him, but he's the brains of the operation. Well, kicking almost straight into that wind, and it only just missed. Well, that's half time. Argentina back in it. They trail by 16. 21 points to 5 into the 2 minute break. Can Argentina plot a path back? Well, let's focus on those scores now, and Tom Cusack picking up the first two. Certainly one of the stars of this Australia side. Jesse Parahi, so experienced, big ball carrier. Swifter decision-making there and able to set up that second score. And this was just a bit too easy for my liking. Confoli finding and exploiting a yawning gap. But there's little Gaston Revol. Feign to go right, sneaks around the left. James Stannard will get us back underway. Australia leading by 21 points to 5. Winner here goes into a playoff for fifth place. It won't be a medal, but it'll still be a decent return. The catch there from Axel Muller. Showing plenty of power on his feet, Muller. He'll play as a wing or as a centre, perhaps even a fullback in his time at Toulon. Imhoff, another man who plays his club rugby for a team of stars in Paris, Racing 92. Oh, there is Imhoff again. This is so much better from the Pumas. Back go the green and gold to knock their man down. Now there's a weight of numbers for Argentina, but they've got to keep the ball in hand. That was Escura. Here is Axel Muller. Tackle, but he retains possession, fires out the offload. Oh dear, that was all a bit tired, wasn't it? From Bautista Escura. He's frustrated, angry with himself. Best lot on his own, I think, with his own thoughts. These two sides very evenly matched in terms of their performances in the World Series this year. Australia finishing fourth, Argentina fifth. So, as things stand, both failing to live up to their billing and their rankings. Maris van der Vesthuizen just saying, I think it came out of the tunnel. That's why we're resetting. So 5.5 minutes to go. Not quite. We'll take three tries from Argentina. They've got to make something happen soon. It's now James Stannard who's trying to take play up towards halfway. Penalty to Australia. Off goes Stannard again. I'm not sure Argentina had retired. Here's Nick Malouf being held up by his opposite number, Fernando Luna. Australia have it. Wedged over the ball there was Con Foley. But Australia guilty there of just sealing off the ball. That's a penalty. Matias Moroni there wearing 6 for the Pumas. Score of that first try. Under the roof. What a dramatic game it was in the World Cup. Ireland falling short in Cardiff. All the try scorers for the Pumas that night in this dozen. One just being replaced, Juan Imhoff. He scored the second and the third tries. They've got to get into a bit of a hurry here of the Argentinians. Nicolas Brazzoni has come on, and look at the sprint there from Gaston Ravol. He's got another one. Well, it was Brazzoni who lit the touch paper. And Gaston Ravol, who finished it all off. Here's the conversion. Gaston Ravol converts his own try. 12 points to 21, 9 points the difference. And more than 3.5 minutes to go, so Argentina could yet turn this one around. Ravol needs one of his specials here. Oh, Argentinians in front of the ball. Free kick. Oh dear, that's indiscipline. That's the guilty party there, Santiago Alvarez. So Cameron Clark it was who took it. Change of direction here. Missing out Ed Jenkins, out to Nick Maloof. Maloof gets the old legs pumping. Oh, and he only manages to find Axel Muller, who offloads it. There's Moroni. There he is again, the captain. Moroni's on his shoulder. Brazzoni it is, sprinting clear. Fine support there from Moroni. Moroni ducks under the tackle of Cameron Clark. And the attentions there of Jesse Parahi and Matthias Moroni may well have pulled off a significant try, not for the first time in the last 12 months for Argentina. Well, they were carried on a combination of the emotion from behind the goal of their Argentinian fans and a little bit of help from a following win, which is picking up. There's the conversion. That's good. Well, we still got 150 to go. A two-point game. This is a bit of a cracker. Next score wins. If we don't get one, Australia are playing off for fifth place. Muller palms it back into the hands of Rival. There goes Luna. He's through his Luna. What a return this is from Argentina. They had a soft 7 minutes in the first half here. Oh, and that's a fumble and a nudge forward from Franco Sabato. Oh dear, oh dear. Well, he's looking for a big hole to open up in the pitch and swallow him up after that. Ouch. Inside the last minute. Australia like a boxer on the ropes. They're getting pummeled, but they know they lead by points. Argentina looking for a knockout blow. Stannard. Clark's looking for it. Good little dummy there from Stannard. I think the ball might have gone forward there. So does the referee. In his view, rather more significant than mine. It was a good little shimmy there from Stannard, but things started to go wrong there with the offload, and Cameron Clark it was who, mainly through his own momentum, managed just to nudge it forward. Big Axel Muller. He's got his eyes for the try line here. That's him on the loose head side of this scrum. Nicolas Brazzoni there, wearing 13. He's the player who came in for Javier Rojas. 7 seconds to go. It's all or nothing here for Argentina. Score a try here. They're playing off for fifth place. If they don't, they've got a match for seventh. Here goes Rival. Oh, he was looking for the inside runner. He wasn't there. There goes Clemens Schultz. This is better from Argentina, really is. There's Rival and little touch inside. There's Moroni back in the opposite direction now. The Argentinians are really finding their voice. Axel Muller, one of the stars of their campaign here. On to Alvarez. Now it's Moroni. Could be a two-on-one here. Can they pull it off? Oh, big hit. Cameron Clark with a tackle. Not all over yet. Time is out. When it goes dead, so do Argentina, unless they can score. And there's Axel Muller. What a tackle! Matthias Moroni. One of the heroes from Cardiff in the 15s World Cup occupies a similar role here in Rio. Axel Muller could have panicked there. Great timing from Moroni. Argentina have turned round what seemed a hopeless cause. Argentina will play off for fifth place. As for Australia, well, they thought, I thought, they'd come back to something like their best. And that was perfection personified. Argentina have beaten Australia by 26 points to 21. Well, we're moving on now to the medal finals. Starting off with the two semis. Fiji against Japan gets us underway. So that is how Fiji got to this stage. Four wins out of four. They conceded the first try against Brazil. The game against Argentina, well, I tell you what, they could well have lost that. They trailed by 7 points with just a couple of minutes left. So they have been tested throughout the course of the tournament, have the Fijians. Now they face a test of a different kind. A team here, the Japanese, who come having built up huge momentum. Japan have never had a sevens tournament like this one. They have been a core team on the World Sevens Series, but frankly, they have yet to make an impact. Well, they've saved it up for these Olympic Games. Japan have been the surprise package. Well, there we can see the Japan squad, led by Lamana Lameki and Lotti Takiri, two of the key names here. And this is their path to this semi-final. That remarkable win against New Zealand was compared, I suppose, inevitably with the Japanese 15 squad victory against South Africa in Bryne last year at the 15s World Cup. Against Great Britain also, of course, a semi-finalist. They came very close indeed. They then put the Kenyans to the sword before coming through the quarterfinals last night. Well, there is Asiya Kolenisau, the captain of this Kenyan team, and here are the five officials, led by Mike Adamson. Craig Joubert, famous 15s rugby referee, is one of the four assistants. And on the right there, you can see Matt O'Brien, once of New Zealand, now a referee in Australia. So alongside me, Keith Quinn. Well, the Fijians have been tested. What sort of surprise you think the Japanese have in store for them?
Look, we don't know that, Martin, because we didn't know anything that the Japanese would throw at us when this tournament began. They beat New Zealand, they went so close to beating Great Britain, they played their way into this situation. The wonderful thing about Japan is that this situation that they're in here has really done more than here at the Olympic Games in Rio. I believe it's set up the sevens competition for the Olympic Games in Tokyo in 2020, because they've done so very, very well. There is the Sipitau being danced by these in the support of the Fijian team. So they've done a lot, Fiji. Japan have done a lot. Let's see how this one unfolds.
The first semi-final. Fiji playing from right to left. They win this, they guarantee themselves a medal. And remember, in 120 years of the modern Olympic Games, Fiji have yet to win a medal. That in itself would be a landmark. Into the hands there of Ravuvu. Swept wide out to Kolenisau. Kolenisau with a cross kick. Haven't seen too many of those in this particular competition yet. We have now. That was Tuasova gathering it. Here's Veramalua. That goes to Asova. He's the human dump truck. He's rather quick as well. Great step. Well, it was a Japan hand that just got in, that of Lameki, and to Asova was appealing for the penalty. Well, that was a bit of indiscipline there from the Japanese, because I don't think there was any need for it. Tuasova was never going to be chasing that. Well, that's an interesting pass. Ball down underarm with the spiral. Out there is Kunitani. And now there's the gap. And here comes the first score. Revuvu.
Yeah, altogether too easy for Revuvu. But look at the amazing one-handed underarm pass. Well, we don't see it there. And it goes out to an equally incredible pass from Kunitani to Revuvu. That was kind of underhand on the backhand. That's showing us all sorts of new tricks in the repertoire. See that from Semi Kunitani? A wonderful pass. Two wonderful, unique passes in that run-up to the try by Revuvu.
Well, Semi Kunitani, who was responsible for that neat little flick out of the back of the hand with the spiral, plays his club rugby at Toulouse, the famous Stade Toulousain in the southwest of France.
Real South Seas flavour here coming in from these Fijian Warriors.
There's the restart from Fiji. Japan have it, spun wide there by Kuazuru. Coming across field there is Lotti Takiri. Well, Japan have showed before that they can take a blow early on in a contest and still come back. The intensity as high as it gets here at these Olympic Games. Great little offload to Takiri. Struggling to keep in play though. Well, the referee's awarded a penalty. And
Revuvu.
This might be worth a bit of a listen here. It's the try score, Revuvu. Well, he's off for 2 minutes.
So this is a real chance here for Japan. They'll have 7 against 6. A charge without using the arms. Have a look at number one with the ball here for Japan, Lemano Lemeki. One of the outstanding players here and a real very good try scorer. Good tactical play. Look at that, a strong kick as well into that crosswind. So there's a good gain of ground here. Let's see it again. There's the charge in the background. That is a bad foul by Revuvu. And he sits in the bin. Look at that. He's in disgrace with himself.
Well, the sort of indiscipline that Ben Ryan, the coach of these Fijians, will just leave him shaking his head. Totally unnecessary. So, 80 seconds or so left on the sin bin. Well, that was an uncompromising hit, and that one was legal. But here's the chance. Space out wide here for Gotto. Gotto's going to go in the corner. Well, the lack of discipline there from Fiji can be measured on the scoreboard. Tario Gotto taking full advantage of the open spaces out wide that have been left by that man who's missing. And suddenly, Japan right back into this match.
Oh, Gotto, that's a beautiful finish. He had a little bit more space with only 6 in opposition. But you're absolutely right, Martin. An early try doesn't sting the Japanese players. They can come back. They've shown it so often. And I want to see Sakai come into the game. He's in the reserves bench. He'll be wearing number 7 when they put him on because he's got flair and talent to burn as well.
Well, that kick pretty much straight into the teeth of the wind. And this particular breeze has got a fair few teeth. It's picking up as the morning progresses. Fiji playing with the advantage of that breeze at the moment. But still, another few seconds left on the sin bin. So Japan will look to regain possession here. There's great hang time on that, but unfortunately, well, once again, it was a 9-iron where he needed a wedge. That is a mistake.
Revuvu back on.
So back to 7 against 7 in this Olympic semi-final. Medals are at stake. The winners here guaranteed to finish on the rostrum. Nakarawa there, the great offloader who's been playing at the Glasgow Warriors for the last couple of seasons. He'll be joining the likes of Juan Imhoff and Dan Carter at Racing 92 when he gets back from this. In retreat was there Varamalua, carrying the ball in one hand. Well, it was a bit of a loose offload, but it's been picked up by Ravuvu. Back after his 2 minutes in the bin. The tackle time there by Hanno. Space for Kalinisau. Kalinisau's got Tuas over alongside him. This man takes a lot of stopping. Through one tackle, round another. This is why this is one of the most highly rated wings in world rugby. He doesn't look like it, but he's just a kid. He is the human dump truck.
You're absolutely right, Martin. He's not particularly fast, I suspect, but look at this. They come at him, and these are good young tacklers, courageous and brave from Japan, but he gets around them. And look at the finish here. Big dive, one for the cameras. There's a whole row of photographers, snappers we call them, on the seats down at each corner. And he turns on one, and he probably sees them sitting there. So shit, this will be a one for the papers.
Well, he bounces off defenders rather like the ball bounces off the edge of those pinball machines. Comes back even harder.
Look at this. They say that every night in Fiji, the team makes the news on the front page and the back page. And it's pictures like this that put them into the news.
And about a year or so ago, there was a real tug of war in Europe because the French Federation had their eyes on Joshua Tuasova. But Ben Ryan, the Fiji coach, is always ahead of the game, said, nope, he's mine. Got him straight into the seventh squad. Takiri, cutting in from the wing. Snapped up by Fiji, on there from Tuasova. Special from Kalinisau, but it's gone forward. Perhaps not quite that special. Half time in the semi-final.
Japan's still in touch though.
So Fiji lead by 10 points to 5. They have the 2 minute break. Well, that's the tale of the tape. Match of two tries. Well, let's just review those two scores here. And this was a very soft try to start off with, just the sort of start the Fijians wanted. Great little pass out of the back of the hand from Kunitani. And Ravuvu, well, he didn't really have to vuvu at all, did he? Just coasting over there in the corner. But then Ravuvu, the sinner, onto the naughty step, in the bin for 2 minutes. And Torio Goto taking full advantage before this man. There is one player who will not fall over all on his own. It is Joshua Tuasova. Tomohiro Sagawa, the Japanese coach. Here's Ben Ryan. Really one of the most forward-thinking coaches, not just in sevens rugby, but world rugby in general. And I rather suspect that if Fiji do emerge with the gold medals here, Ben Ryan's phone will be ringing off the hook. Fiji, 7 minutes away from guaranteeing their first ever Olympic medal. Win this, it's at least a silver. They, though, want the most precious medal of all. Well, they go low, they go high on Tuasova. He brushes them all off. Penalty to the men in white. Playing with so much time here. There goes Ravuvu, back to Kunitani. Oh, Nakarawa. Veramalua, carrying the ball in one hand. So easy, on to Nakarawa. This time it's Kunitani. The Fijians are toying with the Japanese.
Well, that was conjurers at the card table, wasn't it, that one? Beautiful handling of the ball by three huge men. Look at the physical advantage they've got. This is just the last stages of it. One-handed running, passing, eluding the defenders. Well taken try. And things looking ominous here for Japan as the third try comes in from Kunitani.
Well, that was a bit like adults playing with their kids on the beach, wasn't it? Holding the ball high in the air, in the palm and the fingers of one hand. There's Samai Kunitani.
Just remember for Japan, if they were to lose here, they still have a chance for a medal too, which would still be a sensation. They'd play in the bronze medal match. Zezoxia Kulinisau, great leader of the Japan team.
So 15 points to 5. There's the restart from Ravuvu. Long, long wait. The ball hanging up in the wind. Good catch, though, coming from Kuazuru. This time it's with Toyoshima. Little inside ball. Crunching hit. Oh, we went backwards, says the referee. That might have been a little bit fortunate there for Japan. The Japanese, though, utterly fearless. Takiri. Takiri looping around, trying to find a way through. Bit of continuity here from Japan. There's still plenty of time on the clock. There's the kick and the chase. Not really a competition, though. Woof. Well, the referee could well go here for a yellow card. Indeed he does. And it's because of a high hit. It's round the neck. William Mata, one of the impact replacements for Fiji. Really made his presence felt every time he's come off the bench. Look at this. It's Harlan Grove's stuff, isn't it, really? Holding the ball in one hand, playing with such time. Jerry Tuwai. It's looking all too easy for Fiji. This is a very polished performance. You have to wonder, who can possibly stop them? The world's number one side, and they are toying with the opposition.
Yeah, beautiful running again. They had the advantage in this moment of seven players over six, but beautifully constructed tries there, and they keep on coming. That's 4-1 at the moment.
Well, the conversion falls short, as have the previous three. But such is their supremacy. Frankly, it doesn't really matter. 3 minutes on the clock. Well, the other two semi-finalists will be tucked round the back, preparing for their game. In some ways, I guess that's fortunate, because they will be looking at this and thinking, hey, we got the Fijians to come, if we're lucky. The carry there from Kuazuru.
Brave captain, Kuazuru, and underneath that headband, the most beautiful set of cauliflower ears you've ever seen.
Well, Soejima, double hit there. Another feature of Fiji's play at these Olympic Games has been the quality of their rucking. Well, that was almost like a wrestling hold. The little skip there from Toyoshima. Just dipping under the tackles. They're up towards halfway. Well, that Fijian's in an offside position.
Still only six on the field for Japan.
There's the dummy. Forward goes Kuazuru. have to be precise with their passing to Japan. The ball's gone backwards, but, well, he was being shepherded out there. And Fiji here, you get a sense they're only in about second or third gear. On comes Lamano Lemeki.
And coming into the game for Japan is their substitute player who's come in on the third day. And there he is. His name is Ro Dakuwanga. And he's a very interesting player because he plays rugby at a superb level and he only has one eye. So that's a great example of battling against the odds to play and now be an Olympian, Dakuwanga.
Well, the pass there, failing to hit its man. There goes Goto. The pick-up from Lemeki, but the referee decides the ball went forward in the contact. Well, Fiji, in all honesty, have not been tested.
Bringing Sakai on now, right, with just a few seconds to go, very late in the piece for Japan. I thought he was their star runner, but he's just come on right at the very end. He's just going to mark up, you see him there to the right, number seven.
Well, in the end, it's proved to be 14 minutes too far for the Japanese. They will, though, get to contest the bronze medal match. That against the losers of the second semi-final. Taken the ground there by Ravuvu. Oh, great little step. And again, eluding the tackler. He'll need some support here with Domalailai. Oh, dear. That not going to hand. Now a chance maybe for Japan to get something. Well, they're out on their feet. That an uncompromising hit from Viliame Mata. Into the last few seconds, Japan will have the put in at the scrum.
Just think of the interest that there is in this game back in their respective countries. It's the national sport of Fiji, and they've never had that medal at any level of the Olympic Games. But back home in Japan, they will not believe how high the level that this team has reached at the Olympic Games. So interest will be huge back in Japan as well.
Well, Japan, the next World 15s Cup hosts. That happening in a little more than 3 years' time.
We know the World 15s in 2019 and the Olympic Sevens in 2020, all both in Japan. Fantastic, isn't it?
And the national teams have made such huge strides in both codes. We wouldn't have said that in Sevens until, well, 24 hours ago.
That's right.
But they certainly have. They are very much operating in the immediate wake of their 15s colleagues. Japan, that famous win here against New Zealand. There's Fukuoka. Fukuoka, the only player in this Japanese dozen who was involved in Eddie Jones' campaign in England last year with the 15s. On there to Sojima. Lemeki looking around. Lemeki, the inside ball. Well, it snapped up. So, Samisani Viriviri just hoofs the ball into touch, and Fiji have emerged victorious from this semi-final. And in all honesty, I don't think they got out of third gear. This, in many respects, their least testing match of the tournament.
So they'll play in the bronze medal match, and won't that be a thrill for Japanese sevens rugby? But Fiji will win a medal at these Olympic Games.
Well, they're guaranteed at least the silver. They want the gold to the world's number one side. But Fiji now have ended that 120-year wait. They will earn their first ever Olympic medal.
So just another example of the expectations that there are in Fiji for gold success at these Olympic Games. The fans jumping up and down, the flags waving for the Fijian team, having played their way through to the gold medal match here in Rio. Deodoro Stadium, about an hour from central Rio de Janeiro. And look at the weather conditions this afternoon. It's a blustery wind at 23 Ks, temperature's 21. It's a beautiful field to play on, lovely to run on, great to tumble on. And we're through to the second semi-final of the Men's Rugby Sevens Rio Olympics 2016. And it's going to be Great Britain against South Africa. What a matchup this is. We've seen the first semi-final played, and Fiji have gone through to the final, having beaten Japan. Now the second semi-final about to unfold. Well, South Africa won there. Semi-final comfortably, their quarter-final comfortably enough by beating Australia 22-5. But for Great Britain, it was a highly dramatic extra time victory over Argentina. Both sides missed a penalty shot at goal to try to clinch the game late in the action. They went to extra time, and it was Dan Bibby who scored for Great Britain to put them through to this semi-final. But the South African support is well and truly here, as you see, and it's going to be a very even matchup. There's the Great Britain lineup, made up of players from Wales and England and Scotland. And we see that number two, Rory McConachy, is in the starting 12 there for this game. There's their record, unbeaten in four games, including the victory, a narrow victory over Japan that could have been a real upset, the same score over New Zealand, and then that knife-edge victory over Argentina by the late extra time try to Dan Bibby. So Great Britain through. Remember, the Great Britain team only came together 10 weeks ago for their program for this Olympic Games. So this is a wonderful achievement to this point by Coach Simon Amor and Captain Mitchell, Tom Mitchell. And they've brought their supporters with them with high hopes now of going through to play for the gold medal. There's the South African squad of 12 with Francois Hukaat coming in today, injured player. So Francois Hukaat has come in to wear number 13 in their lineup. He's going into the reserves, and there's their record. They had that loss to Australia on the second day in the morning session, but then turned it around with the quarterfinal result against the same opposition late on the second day's play. But this is different. South Africa through. There was two wonderful photographs taken yesterday and appeared in the news media. A photograph of the South African captain and the Australian captain shaking hands in this situation, part of the rugby spirit which is so predominant and has gone around the world here. And the other one was Great Britain players helping Argentinian players to their feet at the end of their massive extra time effort from both teams. Richard Kelly of New Zealand is going to be the referee for this one, assisted by Nick Bryant and Anthony Moyes and Taku Otsuki and Federico Anselmi. Second semi-final, here come Great Britain in the red, South Africa in the green. I'm Keith Quinn, with me is Martin Gillingham. This one, Martin, how do you see it?
Well, the absence of Siabelo Senatla now from the South African dozen is a major body blow. Great Britain have got some real flyers, particularly looking at men like Dan Norton that have coming off the bench, Marcus Watson. But the South African side really do now lack the ultimate fastman. So the lack here of Siabelo Senatla, his injury putting him out of this match, could well be the difference. I'd suggest keep an eye on the roles of James Davis and Kwaka Smith, the two back row forwards in 15s. They are, in many respects, very similar players, have had great Olympic games so far. So keep an eye on those two.
So there is Phil Burgess, hard running forward for Great Britain. Great Britain's team drawn from three nations, showing what true rugby bonding can be. And there's the man that scored the try in extra time that won the way through. Just call him Bibbs. He's the guy that did it. There's their speedster, Great Britain's Dan Norton. And there's Cecil Africa. And there's the referee, Richard Kelly of New Zealand, and Tom Mitchell, who kicked the attempt at a penalty in extra time in the quarterfinal. It hit the top of the post and went away, but England, Great Britain did come back and win it, and here they are battling against South Africa. Great Britain against South Africa, 7 minutes each way for a place in the gold medal match.
Well, you got to wonder how South Africa managed to lose that, because they got the catch there from Philip Snyman, or was it Dylan Sage out wide? But Great Britain have turned it over. James Davis again involved in that. This British team here have really got the first blood in this match. They have possession. Now, can they make it count?
Talking about nicknames, there's Cubby Boy. That's James Davis. We think he's going to be a key man in the outcome of this game. There's Burgess. There is Cubby Boy with the ball. James Davis through the gap he goes. This kid is tough. Ball up to his outsides to Mitchell on the 22. Taken by Phil Snyman for South Africa. Look at this run coming from Roscoe Speckman. Shadowed by Burgess. Big hits, and Davis got back there amazingly. Dylan Sage there. Good reply by South Africa. Philip Snyman. Speckman. No Senatla, remember. There's De Jong. Ripped away by Dan Bibby. Look at these men, the total and utter commitment to the cause. The South African captain, Kyle Brown, try.
Well, the man who created that try, without a doubt, was Phil Snyman. On the ground, claimed possession, and then it was that magnificent little flip out of the back of the hand, the offload, which made things so easy for the captain. This was the run from Roscoe Speckmann, which took them into the Great Britain 22. But then, let's just hope we see that little work here now. There's Quacker Smith, but it's Snyman who goes on to it. Now, look at this pass now. That is the try-scoring pass. The captain just simply had to canter in.
Kick is on its way. There it goes. Bending around in the breeze. And that was a very good kick by Cecil Africa. Some beautiful players in the South African team. There is Roscoe Speckmann. And it came all the way upfield from a strong Great Britain attack. 5-0. Just under 4 minutes to play. James Rodwell, number 5, let that one go over his head and it bounced a touch.
Well, I wonder how fit James Rodwell is, because he picked up that nasty knock, didn't he, in the semi-final against Argentina. Came back towards the end of it, but he's a man who's had to sacrifice more than many people to get to this stage. Rodwell is an absolutely key player for Great Britain. Let's hope he's fully fit.
Yeah, he limped off halfway through the season and has looked like his Olympic ambitions would be over. But he's here, but struggling a little bit. Well, look at this. From Burgess. Now Burgess might look like a forward and is listed as a forward, but he's a very good runner. And that's against South Africa. Look how quickly the South Africans are back. They're playing with good discipline.
Dylan Sage there with the high tackle. Did well to get back, but it's good to see the referee being hard on those high challenges.
Do you know, when they're all added up over this Olympic campaign, Martin, I think the high tackles is probably one of the decisions made by the referees and penalties of anything in the game.
Yeah, the safety element of rugby, yeah, both at sevens and 15s, is absolutely key these days to world rugby. Look at Rodwell.
James Rodwell, 40 metres out, tumbles over the top. It's gone on the South African side. Burgess clears it. The same runner, Speckmann. Chased by Burgess, chased by Norton. Norton's quick. Norton's tackle is secure. But it's 5 metres out on the Great Britain side. Quacker Smith floats it wide. And did the wind capture that one?
Well, I tell you what, I started off this game really talking up Quacker Smith. But first of all, the decision making. There were 3 green and gold jerseys on their own, unmarked out wide to the right. He chose to go left, and then he threw a shocking pass. That was a try, should have been for South Africa. Great running, Emron Speckmann. Following up here is Cecil Africa. He's first on the scene, but this really should have been a score. Now look at Smith. He receives it. He should have gone left. Should have gone right, I should say, but he went left.
These guys love it, don't they? A little bit of a grin from Kyle Brown. We saw that yesterday as he packed in against his opposite captain. And there's Bibby simply clearing it away to touch. That's quite a rarity. Look at the crowd in the background. They've come in. The maximum crowd here is about 16,000 stadium, and it's pretty full here. Lovely warm conditions to watch and high action rugby sevens for them to concentrate on and enjoy.
That was a great tackle, wasn't it, from Dan Norton? Fastest man on the pitch.
Chased hard. So much to play for. Okay, Davis again. What a run again by Davis. Finds Bibby. Mitchell is there. They've overrun the ball. Great Britain have it.
Well, what a break from James Davis. They say in South Wales at the moment he's maybe a bit too small to play in the back row at 15s. His elder brother is Jonathan Davies, the famous centre. Well, I tell you what, this fella now is stepping well and truly out of his shadow. He's away, but then look at this tackle. Juan de Jong, who's coming back into the 15s for returning. In fact, I beg your pardon, it was Philip Snyman who came back, wasn't it, that made that particular tackle. It was de Jong who was following up there. But that's the first time I think South Africa have been seriously tested here.
Quickly taken by Cecil Africa from that penalty. There is Brown. Speckman, who's played a good hand so far. Africa, the veteran. And that will take us to half-time. It's a thriller minute here. Just one try in it to Kyle Brown, the South African captain. And we go to the break where they recalibrate and get set for the second half. Men's Rugby Sevens second semi-final.
Well, South Africa will be kicking themselves. They will feel that they should be more than 5 points ahead. It's as simple as that. They wasted a few opportunities. They've been well and truly on top of Great Britain. But Great Britain have perhaps had their softest 7 minutes in the tournament so far. Of course, that in itself is a bit of a compliment to South Africa, who have really squeezed them. But Great Britain still very much back in this match.
Their deep breathing routine. But here was the run by Roscoe Speckman. Did a nice little pirouette there, a turn. And then that excellent pass, there it was there from Snyman to Brown. And he put the ball out away from the defence coming across. And the try was scored. That's the only one of the first half. Here is Neil Powell. Simon Amor.
But it's very much an upbeat approach, isn't it, from Simon Amor. He's saying that he wants to see more speed to the breakdowns. He feels he's been beaten in that element of the game by South Africa.
Wonderful atmosphere here at the Deodoro Stadium in Rio. First semi-final was a good one for Fiji over Japan. Great encouragement for Japan, even though they lost. Fiji played their way through, and now this is a knife-edge battle we've got here at the moment. That's the lovely artwork on the arms of François Oukat, the replacement who's come in for the third day's play for South Africa. So, long shadows appearing in the early afternoon here in Rio. Great Britain in the red.
Interesting alteration being made by South Africa. Cheslin Kolbe, who hasn't had that much game time, is on.
So let's see how it runs this time. Here's Rodwell, goes into the tackle, a little tentatively. We still have our suspicions about him, don't we, Martin, about his full fitness. And then they, no doubt about the toughness of these guys, of Davis and Bibby. And there they go in combination again. Big pass by Davis to Burgess. Out wide to Norton. Now he's the quick man. He's Mr. Quick. And Great Britain are on the board. Dan Norton scores it. It's 5-all, kick to come.
Well, Dylan Sage was left with flat feet, wasn't he, by Dan Norton. This fella is one of the great sevens players. There's Dan Bibby, the semi-final hero. Fly half in the 15s game. James Davis again playing his role. But then it was just simple passing off the left hand, and Norton gets to line up his man. And Dan Norton can do those sort of things virtually in his sleep. What a semi-final we've got.
Beautiful run in by Norton, very elusive runner that he is. Dan Norton scored 210 tries on the World Rugby Tours events. Conversion is over from Tom Mitchell. Great Britain leading by 7-5. And there's the captain. It's his team added those important conversions. And now an important kickoff to see whether there's enough hang time for his guy to get under it. Rodwell tried, but it went on the South African side thanks to Kyle Brown. Juan de Jong, midfield. In goes Quokka Smith.
Well, you could see the extra ferocity there from the Britons at the breakdown, but that was well controlled by South Africa. But what a reclaim from the restart that was from Kyle Brown, rising high.
So Justin Hiddelt is onto the field. You can probably hear the wind blowing in into our microphones there. That wind has got up. It's playing quite a part in the tactical way the game is going, probably a little on an angle across the field. Snyman fumbled.
Pass wasn't the best and it came unforced, but really, if you're a world-class sevens player, you've got to expect to take that. He wasn't under any sort of pressure at all. And now as we get into the last 4 minutes, those are not the sort of mistakes that South Africa can afford to make. Britain here making a change. James Davis is off and on in his place, wearing one, is Mark Robertson, the Scot.
Pretty good effort there by James Davis. In fact, I'll say a very good effort indeed. Made about three or four runs, was it, while he was on the field. They were very testing to the South African defences. And now Tom Mitchell. Here they come again out through the backs. This is Mark Bennett who's onto the field, the full 15s international player. Just one of the very rare players who went to the World Cup in 15s last year and has played in the Six Nations recently. So he's a good one. Halfway line. Dijon, good work. Now here's Tim Agaba. Burgess.
Well, this time it's Gadol who gets himself isolated there in the tackle. Inside the last 3 minutes. Yes, it's just the support just isn't there. Great work from England that time at the breakdown. Over the ball there, Tom Mitchell, the captain. You've got to admire Tom Mitchell, haven't you? He really does have all the skills. He's a man who came through Bristol University, played for Oxford in a varsity match, and he settled in so well into sevens play. Real thinking captain. There he is, super player.
As they made a sub there to Great Britain, they brought on Sam Cross. So one Welshman's gone off, another one's come on, but they get a real good value out of Cross as well too. So there's Mitchell, the captain, pushing across the, with his kick across the breeze, which is quite serious now in favour of Great Britain, and they're in the lead narrowly. 2.5 to play till they can say we are in the world debut of sevens and the gold medal match. Equally, the South Africans have got to battle back. See the number 13 there? That's Hukat. It's on the Great Britain side. And here's Bibby out into the centre. Real big hit on Watson, who's come into the game. Marcus Watson, he's another speedster. Norton is there. They tumble back and this is the referee.
Well, what a tackle that was by Juan de Jong. Cut his man down. Marcus Watson right round the ankles. It's led to the penalty for South Africa. They got 2 minutes left. They now have to take their chance.
So there is Hukat. He's also played in the Rugby World Cup for the 15-a-side version.
He's also been a revelation for Worcester in the Aviva Premiership, went over to England in February and he helped keep Worcester in the top division, so he's in good form.
So here he is, doing his bit for South Africa as they come towards the 22. It's on the right side there as they move the ball out along the back line. Here's Agaba, this huge man in midfield. Now it's with Quaker Smith. He's got a pass out wide to Cheslin Kobe, and trying to run it out was Mark Robertson. Now this is a critical moment of decision in the match.
Well, the penalty there against Marcus Watson, but you do feel if South Africa are going to be a little more clinical, they should have got that try. They had men over. There was just a little lack of precision. It's where they need a man like Sanatla. They're missing him, there's no doubt.
So this time they've got it to De Jong. Now a set move will be planned by South Africa, but set defence is two from Great Britain. They move it this time. Oh, there's a big hit by Burgess. That might turn the ball over for Great Britain. No, it's gone to Brown and South Africa. The big ball floated out wide. It's gone forward. It's gone forward, called by referee Kelly of New Zealand.
Well, it was unnecessarily complicated, wasn't it? The long pass out there on the bounce, trying to find Cheslin Kolbe. And South Africa, if they don't win this match, will rue the opportunities they've had. Quaker Smith in the first half, and now that one, with less than a minute on the clock. Great Britain will feel that they have got a foot in this final.
Simon Amor, excitement on the bench down here as they try to stop a player coming on, I think it was. Sam Cross on. So going on for South Africa with Werner Kock. That's him in the front row to the right. So we've got Brown and Kock to the right. And Quaker Smith in the middle. Francois Hougaard and Tom Mitchell with the ball. Chance for England to clear. Remember, just 20 seconds to play. And Great Britain might have played it in their way into the final.
Well, Great Britain are perfectly happy with this. The clock shows 15 seconds. That clock can't turn over quick enough for the Great Britain team here.
Well done to the ref for stopping the clock there. So there's no trying to just delay things. The clock is still stopped. So time is on. 15 seconds to play. Great Britain could just about delay it enough to kick it out and go to the final. There they're going to try, are they? Oh, they give it to Norton, and Norton subs it. And that's not a bad thing to do. He waited till he heard the siren. That's amazing. That's some modern technology. Now, Nick Bryant is going to be talked to here. Did he kick it out before the siren went? Yes, there's got to be one more play. I think Norton waited to hear the siren. He would have been looking at the board to see how many seconds remained, and it went out seemingly as the siren sounded. That they discussed it, Nick Bryant, the referee's assistant there with the flag, and the referee, Richard Kelly, and they said one more play. Now, will this be the play for South Africa to play their way into the gold medal match? Great leap for Great Britain by Sam Cross. Oh, an awkward pass for South Africa.
It was a great take from De Jong, wasn't it?
45 metres out, De Jong took it in. They're still alive. South Africa, the score is against them. Brown. Big tackle by... No, it's missed. It's a breakout by Kolbe. That's him, number seven. 40 metres out now. Is that Cross ripping it for England? Bibby is there. Bibby gets it. And Bibby, as he did in the quarterfinal, has the final say in the semi-final by kicking it out. And who would have believed it? Great Britain march on to the gold medal match.
Well, what a performance this has been by Great Britain. South Africa will rue the missed chances. They were even presented one right at the death there that maybe they didn't deserve. They have had chances in this match. but they simply haven't taken them. It's been a thoroughly professional performance by Great Britain. They lived on their nerves last night. They've done exactly the same here. Great Britain, the new team. Well, they're still within the warranty, aren't they? They've only been around for a few weeks.
They have indeed. And look at this. These are Welshmen and Englishmen and Scotsmen playing together in the true bonding story of a rugby team. And look at these moments. One more big game to play, but what a game it'll be. The gold medal match comes on the end of this result. Great Britain 7, South Africa 5. And so we see a final between Fiji and Great Britain and South Africa to play Japan for the bronze medal. So wonderful scenes here of joy and disappointment. James Rodwell, these guys have been around the scene on the World Sevens Tour playing with the England shirts on, admittedly, and the other guys like Mark Robertson and James Davis in recent times, and a lot of these South African guys for years and years and years. And this was going to be the big one. But for every match like this, there's got to be a winner and there's got to be a loser, because there is so much at stake, and enormous disappointment for the brave South Africans. There's just a quick look at the coach, Neil Powell, a wonderful man, a very quietly spoken, a very dignified man who's coached South Africa to this point. And there's somebody in the Great Britain team says, oh, crikey. And there is Neil Powell. And what a dignified and decent person he is. And he's done so well with the team, but he could take them now to a bronze medal match. It's not what he wanted. It's not what any of them wanted. But they gave everything to the semi-final. And, well, they have to say that Great Britain squeaked it. Simon Amor, a great player himself. And in the tradition of South African sporting teams and so many other sporting teams, they bow their heads at the end of superior effort, win, lose or draw. So they have one game to go, and that'll be the bronze medal match for South Africa. And you heard the word bokke there. That's the pride of South Africa, the Blitzbokke Sevens team. And so we have reached this situation in men's rugby sevens, where to the right you see the last teams standing, Fiji and New Zealand playing for the gold medal, but the bronze medal will be played between Japan and these colours representing South Africa. So I guess the first disappointment for the South African team as they walk away, that they weren't able to have Siyabala Senatla in their lineup. And there's the Team GB flag that I think first came in 2012 in Great Britain. It's certainly been flourishing here, and it's got them through to the final. Wonderful scenes here. So what a session we've had here on day three of men's rugby at Deodoro Stadium in Rio. We've now found our two finalists for the gold medal match, and you've seen the wonderful images from the matches we've seen this morning from all the teams who gave us so much. We've seen plenty of plenty, and there's plenty more to come when the finals are played in the final session this afternoon here in Rio. These fans will be back, and we hope wherever you're watching, you will be too, because this is rugby sevens Olympic style, and maybe the best is yet to come.